5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. We are live, sir.
Good evening, everyone. Chairman, Indian School of Urology, Professor Rajiv Sood. President-elect, Urological Society of India, Dr. C. Mallikarjun. Co-chairman, Indian School of Urology, Dr. Arun Chawla. Convener of the Pediatric Urology Subspecialty Session, Dr. Anil Takwani. The faculty members, the student participants, the members from Urological Society of India and SAARC countries, a very good evening to all of you. Today, we are having the last zonal round. Today is the East Zone. And we were having a good response all through these days in the last four zonal competition rounds. Today also, we expect quite a good number of viewers for this participation. And this has attracted good interest across the members of the Urological Society of India. So I wish all the participants and their mentors all the very best for this competition. With this, I welcome you all again. Now I request the Chairman in the Indian School of Urology, Dr. Rajiv Sood, to say a few words. Over to you, sir. So you are muted. Kindly unmute. So kindly unmute, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Rajiv. This is a great day today because the initiative which was taken by USI ISU and the vision which was there for everybody and for the future of urology, that is getting fulfilled by this program of subspecialty, unique in nature and very well coordinated and organized by Rajiv TP and Takwani and also.
Sir, your audio, sir.
Pardon?
Yeah, audio, sir. Yeah, now it's okay, sir.
Okay. So, actually, I'm in a cab, so I'm traveling. I was telling that the initiative which has been taken by Anil Takwani, Dr. Rajiv TP's guidance and inputs and also Arun Chawla, this has gone long way. This is a moment of remembrance and the vision getting fulfilled and the subspecialty of pediatric urology has done wonders. And this will be remembered in the annals of Urology Society. What has happened that all the residents and consultants and also the mentors and moderators, they are so keenly participating that other subspecialties are induced now. And our vision of subspecialty-based USI functioning is getting fulfilled. The archives which are getting created will be as treasure for USI for future. And also will pave the way to create the uniform curriculum for urological education in India. So this is the final penultimate day, the final day, and the fourth zone is going to participate. All the good luck to all the participants today, teams, and also the future of this competition. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your enlightening words. Now I will request the President-elect Urological Society of India, Dr. C. Mallikarjuna, to say a few words. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Rajiv. It's a wonderful job which you're being done in the last 4 days. I missed the last day, but I think this is one of its kind. Possibly Corona has taught us a lot and we are teaching ourselves a lot in the last Corona. Whatever pandemic which has happened good to us is this what happening, I think probably. Keep up the wonderful work and I need to waste more time. We can go ahead with the thing.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now I will request Dr. Anil Takwani, convener of Pediatric Urology Subspecialty, to carry forward with the competition. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, Rajiv, thank you once again. Thank you for this opportunity to you as well as Dr. Sood, Dr. Chawla, Dr. Mallikarjun. and warm welcome to all of you. And first of all, request as usual, Manoj, you are not mute. So please mute yourself. Gyanendra, mute yourself. So all those who are just listening and not talking, they will keep themselves mute in this particular segment. On other, see, these are the experts and speakers and the dignitaries and office bearers are only allowed on this side of the segment. But they have to be very careful of keeping themselves mute while the student is speaking and the questions and answers are going on. And another request to the experts, that experts are allowed to unmute themselves, but those experts, only those who are requested to ask the questions. Rest of the experts will keep themselves mute. And till the moderator doesn't come to him, he will still keep on keeping him mute. The reason is that we want to avoid completely this background noises, right? So please help in that particular, because sometime when you start asking the questions, you unmute yourself, but see that once your questions answers are finished, you are again making yourself mute. With that small remark, warm welcome to all of you, and just little bit of feedback that we are getting day and day a very positive response from the viewers as well as from the experts. Last segment, we had a Pramod Reddy there from the Cincinnati join, and in the final, he showed his willingness to join again in the final. And we have a couple of other international friends of pediatric urologists of specialty who we are planning to invite with the permission of the secretary's office as well as council office. And we'll give the list again to you, Rajiv, for that. We'll talk a little later on that. And so that's very much encouraging to all of us, those belongs to pediatric urology subspecialty committee. And with that, today we have a East Zone students and teachers are performing. So all the best to all the six team. And Dr. Rahul Kapoor is going to do moderating of this particular session. And as and when necessary, I will be trying to help him. So with that, I once again welcome all of you. And Rahul, you can start moderating. And the first speaker be ready to share the screen. And on behalf of the first speaker, actually, the team is going to share the screen from their backup.
Good evening, everyone. I am honored to be the moderator for this session. We have reached the last stage of preliminary round, the East Zone. We have six teams. I would like to invite all the panelists, the students and their teacher. Without wasting time, I'll start with Dr. Manoj Kumar Singh, along with his teacher, Dr. Ehsan Ahmed, who's from IGIMS Patna, Bihar, and he's presenting on management of nocturnal aneurysms.
Amit, you are watching through the Dr. Panda's screen. So keep yourself mute, sir.
Manoj,
yes, someone, Dr. Panda, can you keep yourself mute? Hello, Amit. So where is the...
Can you tell the technical team to upload his presentation?
Yes, sir.
Hello. Sir, am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible. You can start.
Yes, sir. Good evening to all of you. I am Dr. Manoj Kumar Singh from IGMS Patna. My mentor is Dr. Ehsan Ahmed. I'll be speaking on the topic, which is management of nocturnal aneurysms. Please change the slide. So it is defined as a simple aneurysm or bedwetting at the urinary incontinence during sleep in children more than 5 years of age, at least twice a week for a consecutive 3 months. Next. It can be two types, monosymptomatic and non-monosymptomatic. Mono means only bedwetting without any daytime alerts, and non-monosymptomatic means with bedwetting and daytime alerts. Next. It can be primary and secondary. Primary means there is history of bedwetting and he has never been dry. Secondary means there is a history of dryness of at least 6 months. Next. So the neural control, when bladder is filling through the spinal tract, it goes to pons and the cerebral cortex. So by 5 years of age, the child should have cerebral control over the pons. Next. Physiology, a child should work normally at least 4 to 7 times a day. The normal residual urine should not be more than 10% of the maximum bladder capacity. At urine, at night, the urine volume is less in response to the circadian rhythm of ADH. Next. Maturation of bladder, by 2 years of age, they have normal sensation of the bladder filling. By 3 years of age, they are able to void voluntarily. By 4 years of age, the pattern is like adult. Females acquire bladder control before boys. Next. The epidemiology, it is common but underreported. Worldwide, it is between 6 to 12 years of age. It is as high as 28%. In India, some data are there which says it is between 7.6 to 16.3%, highest in the age group of 5 to 8 years. And in India, with sleep problem, the child have at least 18.4%. Next. It is more in poor socioeconomic class in India. Families is both in rural and urban. And it is said that there is gradual decrease in bedwetting as the child grows. By 15 years of age, it is only 1%. It is more common in male than female. Next. So there are studies by D'Souza, Solanki, Srivastava and all, and they have all found that it is more common in male than female, but only study by Solanki in 2014 found out it is more common in female. I would like to add one thing, that daytime incontinence is more common in female. Next. So it results at rate of 15% per year, and at the age of 15 years, it is only 1%. Next. So how big is the problem? There has been a study in UK by Dunlop et al, who has said that 68% of the parents said that their family physician never addressed bedwetting. Many parents believe that it is not a physical condition and they don't want to talk about it. And some of them think that the patient will outgrow the problem. Next. So there is impact of bedwetting on the child, parents, and the family. There is feeling of failure. It results in stress. The emotional state is altered, poor self-esteem, poor relation with the parents and the peer. There is school dropout. There increased risk of physical and the emotional abuse. But after dryness, it has been seen that there is high self-esteem and better relationships. Next. Etiology, the exact cause is not known. But there are some many factors like genetic factor. If one parent had history of bedwetting, there is 44% chance. If the both parents, then 77% chance is there. There is one gene called NUR1 mutation of which on the chromosomes 12, 13, and 22 leads to bedwetting. Behavioral, there is ADHD, obstructive sleep apnea are there. Next. But there are mainly three factors: in kidney, nocturnal polyuria, in bladder, a small bladder capacity, and in brain, impaired arousal from sleep. Next. So this is the triad between brain, kidney, and bladder. Next. So how to evaluate? From the history, we have to rule out first whether it is primary or secondary, how is the pattern of the neurosis, how many nights per week, how many episodes per night, pattern of nighttime fluid intake, we have to see the storage in the voiding, daytime symptoms, the detailed family history, and any comorbidity. Next. On examination, distended bladder, fecal impaction, you have to see the genitalia, ear, nose, throat for any physical and the sexual abuse, neurological assessment, routine urine, and you have to see for UTI, blood sugar, KPN, thyroid concentration, and you have to see the growth chart as well. Next. You have to see the uroflowmetry and the ultrasound. UDS, generally, it is not required, but in ultrasound, if you think that there is bladder wall thickness, so there can be bladder overactivity, and in those cases, sometimes UDS may be done. Next. Boarding diary and bedwetting diary is paramount. Next. Please be fast. Next. So one is boarding diary and one is the for bladder bowel dysfunction. Of course, we have to do other possible causes of the neurosis like spinal dysraphism, posterior thyroid valve, and other bladder bowel dysfunction, UTI, diabetes mellitus, and insipidus. Next. So the treatment goal is you have to increase the number of dry nights. You have to minimize the emotional impact of nocturnal neurosis. Next. So there are three options: behavioral therapy, moisture alarm, and pharmacotherapy. Next. So in behavioral therapy, you have to reassure the child and the parents, the bowel habit. If there is bowel habit is altered, then you have to treat that. The habit you have to correct. You have to ask the child to pass urine before going to bed, fluid restriction from the evening. You have to discourage the holding maneuvers, You have to reward for every dry night. And from behavioral therapy, there is complete resolution in 25% of the cases by 3 to 6 months. Next. Then there is moisture alarm. For this moisture alarm, the patient and the parents both has to be motivated. It works on the mechanism of Pavlovian conditioning, where there is suppression of the bladder contraction during sleep, and it increases the nocturnal bladder volume. Next. Should be used more than 7 years of age. At least we should use for 16 weeks. And it in the first week, it requires a lot of cooperation from the other kids in the family and the parent. Next. There has been many trials which have said that there is effective long-term improvement from the moisture alarm therapy. But if there is 14 dry nights, then we should stop it. If we do not get the moisture alarm, then we can also use the simple alarm, the clock. Next. Desmopressin, anticholinergics, and the TCA are the other pharmacotherapy. Next. Desmopressin can be used for the last 50 years. It is most effective in if there is nocturnal polyuria. And the response is 60% to 70% of the cases. It comes in many formulations like melt and tab and sublingual. Next. Most effective is melt because it matches with the sleep period of the child. Next. So it matches with the sleep pattern of the child. Next. So there are many studies. EC in 2002, the response rate with desmopressin was 74%. The initial dose was 0.2 milligram, and the response was there was a decrease in wet night from 5.75 to 1 per week with the standard dose of 0.2. Dose increase from 0.2 to 4 showed increased response. Next, and there was no hyponatremia. There were two studies by Skullman and Scoop, which also said that with the increase of the dose from 0.2 to 0.4, there was increased response. Next. Desmopressin with oxybutynin had better response than the desmopressin alone. Next. And so as true for toltradine as well. Next. Desmopressin with wet alarm showed the greatest response for nocturnal neurosis. Next. So the best is wet alarm plus desmopressin. With desmopressin, after 3 months of the treatment, it was seen that there was relapse. So we should always taper the dose from 0.6 to 0.2 milligram slowly. Next. Anticholinergics monotherapy are not in use, but it can be used in if there is detusor overactivity in non-monosymptomatic patient. Next. TCA, mostly next. It is third line treatment, mostly with imipramine. Next.
Manoj, you finish your talk comfortably. No problem.
1 hour prior to sleep. Yes, sir. But after 1 month, we have to assess the function. So all the treatment, it is seen that motivational therapy and the alarm had lowest relapse rate. Rest, all of them had a lot of relapse. Next. So for the dedicated care of the nocturnal neurosis, there should be a bed wetting clinic in our OPDs, which will comprise of a urologist, child specialist, and psychologist for better evaluation and management. In India, we still are at infancy of this bed wetting clinic, but if you want to improve our management of nocturnal neurosis, then there should be a bed wetting clinic in India as well. Next. Thank you.
So before we go to the question and answer segment, once again, I request Dr. Panda that, sir, someone has logged in from the two system. Your second system is not mute. We are seeing two Sabyasachi Panda. One is mute. Another is not mute, sir. I request all of you to see that you are definitely muted. See, another screen, I am seeing someone is a mask, yellow mask, but that system is not mute.
That's Amit only. I think they were initially on two computers, sir. Okay.
Sir, sir, someone is still making little bit disturbances. So we have to be sure about that. No hurry. But check that every system is mute except the experts who are going to be request to ask the questions. Rahul, you can go ahead.
I would like to now request Prasanna sir to start the first question.
Thank you, Dr. Manoj, for your presentation. My first question, I have three questions, but my first question is, what do you think is the single most important evaluation tool for nocturnal aneurysis?
Sir, first we have to take the history. How many times?
Just name one tool, one, which is the most important.
Sir, wording diary.
Yeah, okay, correct. Second is, when you're speaking about desmopressin,
yes, sir.
What is the difference between desmopressin melt, which is the dispersible form, the spray and the tablet? Which of the three has proven to be more effective, current standard?
Yes. So the most effective is the melt form, which is the sublingual form.
Why?
Sir, because the T half of melt is 1 to 2 hours and it matches with the sleep pattern of the child. Moreover, in the spray form, it is not used nowadays because there is a lot of hyponatremia and seizures and all. So we don't use spray form now. So the most used form is melt form or sublingual form, sir.
Right. My last question is refractory nocturnal aneurysis means you've treated...
Yes, sir.
You evaluated and adequately treated a child with nocturnal aneurysis.
Yes, sir.
But no matter what you do, the response is very minimal. What do you think are the probable reasons?
Sir, number one, maybe there is no support of the child from the parents. There is constant stress in the family, number one. Number two, the compliance from the child is poor. And number three, sir, maybe bladder bowel dysfunction as well, if at all it is there.
Right. I would agree with you. First thing is compliance of the child and the family.
Yes.
But most importantly,
yes,
from our side, as clinicians, we need to have a relook whether we have missed something else. Thank you. Over to Dr. Rahul again.
Thanks. Thanks very much, sir. Can I request Dr. Chandra Singh, sir, to ask the question?
Yes, Dr. Manoj, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Thank you for the wonderful presentation. I have two questions. One is, if I were to ask you to choose just one modality, what would be your choice and what is the reason for that?
Sir, I will choose behavioral therapy because it is most effective and the relapse rate is quite less with behavioral therapy. And if it is not working for 16 weeks, they have said in many studies, if it is not working, not helping, then I will go for moisture alarm therapy. These two combined. But if there is nocturnal polyuria as well, which I will know by weight of the pad, which will leak at night. If there is nocturnal polyuria as well, then I will move ahead with desmopressin.
Okay. Thank you. Second question is to just to test your practical applicability.
Right.
In literature, the extent of fuss that you see in the US and the Europe is far more than what it is in our country. What do you think is the reason for that?
Because, sir, most of the families of this child, they don't think that this is a problem. And they think that this will be with age, this will be cured. And number two, we also don't address the problem of nocturnal aneurysis. And
these two
only.
Okay. Thank you.
Manoj, what exactly you do in your hospital when the child comes? At what age you start treating and what is your first treatment?
Yes. First of all, sir, I will start when the child is more than equal to 5 years of age. The first treatment, sir, will give the behavioral therapy, the fluid restriction and all.
And how? What is the compliance with the alarm?
Alarm compliance, sir, most of the cases they come and say that they have not got the alarm as well, sir. So we ask them to use the normal clock and all. And with that also the response is quite okay, sir.
So you don't see the non-compliance or failure. So what exactly you do if they say that they are not okay with the alarm? What next you add?
The time boarding at night, sir, by the parents. Okay. They have to ask them to wake up.
Any role of imipramine in your practice?
Imipramine, so in the studies are there, sir, but...
in your practice?
No, sir, we have not used.
Okay. Okay. So, we can have still one more question.
We can have one more question.
5 minutes over.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so...
We'll go to the second presentation. The second presentation is by Dr. Vishrut Bharti. His teacher is Dr. Rohit Upadhyaya. He's presenting IGI-MS Patna, and he'll be talking on role of ESWL in pediatric urolithiasis. Vishrut, you can share your screen.
Sir, my screen is visible?
You are audible. You can go.
A very good evening to all the panelists. So I will be presenting the role of ESWL in pediatric urolithiasis under the mentorship of Dr. Rohit Upadhyaya. So starting with this, in 1980, Chaussy et al. First introduced the technique of shockwave lithotripsy. And with this, we entered in an era of non-invasive therapy for urolithiasis. 6 years following that, Newman et al. Published its first experience in pediatric ESWL. And since then, it has maintained its broad applicability as suggested by various guidelines. So what are the questions that need to be answered? Is ESWL more effective in children than in adults? What is the exact role of ESWL in the broad spectrum of therapies for urolithiasis? Do children require the same technical parameters as adults? And is it safe for children to have this treatment? And what are its long-term effects? So what is the efficacy of ESWL? The overall efficacy in children has been seen to be higher than that in adults. And what are the factors responsible for this? Probably a smaller body size leading to a shorter stone to skin distance, a more pliable ureter, allowing larger fragments to pass through, and a shorter ureteric length that has to be traversed. So what is this role in renal stones of less than 2 cm? So the reported stone-free rates for shockwave lithotripsy is 80 to 85% compared to 85% for flexible URS, although with a higher complication rate of URS of 12 to 20.5%. So it makes this one of the first line therapy for this stone size. Although inferior results have been reported with patients with history of previous surgery and with stones of cysteine and calcium oxalate monohydrate composition. On sub-analysis of this group, better success rate and stone-free rates have been noted for less than 10 mm, while for 10 to 20 mm, the success rate falls while the URS maintains its success rate. In this study by Badaway et al., they have shown a better success rate of 93% for less than 10 mm compared to 85% for more than 10 mm stones. In this another systemic review and meta-analysis by Liu et al. In the year 2015, they have suggested a risk ratio of 1.14, suggesting significantly better stone-free rates for less than 10 mm. In this another study by Mokles et al., they compared the result in the stone sizes of 10 mm of shockwave lithotripsy versus flexible URS and found the success rate of URS to be 86% as compared to 70% for the shockwave group. So what do the guidelines say? The AUA guidelines recommend shockwave lithotripsy or URS may be offered as first-line treatment therapy for renal stones of less than 20 mm. While the AUA recommends for renal stones of smaller than 20 mm to offer SWL as the first-line treatment with RIRS as a feasible alternative. So its role in renal stones of more than 2 cm or Stagon calculus. Many studies have reported a stone-free rates of 71 to 86% in large Stagon stones with low complication rate. Stone-free rates of PCNL, another option for this stone size, is 71 to 95%, although with a high complication rate of 20%. So with its minimally invasive nature, shockwave lithotripsy still remains a viable option, although with higher rates of pretreatment and auxiliary procedures. In this study by Al Busdey, they reported a success rate of 79 to 80%, and they also reported a decrease of complication rate from 21 to 0% by adopting pre-stenting ESWL patients. AUA 2016 also recommends pre-stenting in patients with more than 20 mm sizes. There are many other studies, as can be seen here, which puts good success rate of 73 to 86% in the past with Stagon calculus. Coming to the guidelines, that AUA recommends for stones of more than 20 mm, both PCNL and SWL as acceptable treatment options, while EAU recommends PCNL should be offered for more than 20 mm stone sizes. Its role in uretric stones. Stone-free rate of uretric stones is 87% compared to 95% for URS. Although inferior results have been noted for stones of larger than 10 mm with both modalities and a higher retreatment rate. Stone-free rate for lower uretric stones falls a bit with 76 to 89% and the overall efficacy is less than as compared to proximal stones. In this study by Badaway et al, they have shown an inferior result for more than 10 mm stones of 43% compared to 91%. And also an inferior result for distal uretric stones. In this meta-analysis by Lu et al, they reported a risk ratio of 1.07, indicating a higher success rate for proximal uretric stones. Coming to the guidelines, the EUA says to offer children with single uretric stones of less than 10 mm shockwave lithotripsy as the first line option. While AUA suggests that pediatric patients who have failed observation or are unlikely to pass should be offered ESWL or URS. What are the contraindications? Uncontrolled bleeding diastasis, hypertension, untreated infections, arterial aneurysms, or obstructions distal to the stones. So before the procedure, how can we predict the success? It depends on many factors, as has been summarized here in this nomogram. Many such nomograms exist. This one includes factors like gender, age, stone size, stone number, stone location, and previous interventions. Coming to the technical aspect, the pre-procedural antibiotics are not routinely indicated and as indicated only in pre-dwelling stents or infected stones. Other aspects remain similar to that of adults, although the anesthesia recommendations are general anesthesia for younger children, while pseudoanalgesia can suffice for older children, especially with newer generation lithotripters. A power setting of 16 to 20 kV has been reported in most studies and literature, although definitive recommendations do not exist, although EAU recommends gradual escalation of voltage throughout the procedure. Shockwave frequency of 60 to 90 per minute has been recommended to increase the stone combination and decrease the injury. Complications include hematuria, which is mostly self-limiting, renal function deterioration in the form of transient proximal tubular damage or transient proteinuria exist, take longer for children to resolve. Renal colic exists for 2 to 4% patients, mostly managed conservatively. UTI can happen. Stain straws occurs with a frequency of 4 to 7% and stone size for this is a major risk factor. Pre-SWL setting, although does not affect its incidence, but prevents its complication. Most of such cases are managed conservatively. If not, shockwave lithotripsy or ureteroscopy can be used to treat such patients. Hematoma, again, is a self-limiting and asymptomatic complication. Coming to the long-term effects. The reproductive organs, which is a major concern, in this both animal and human studies have shown no harmful effect on both ovary and sperm morphology. Hypertension is a controversial topic, though. And various studies in the past, including a meta-analysis by UC et al. In 2014, showed no statistical significant risk of hypertension. Although a recent cohort study shows a risk of 40% risk of incident hypertension with a hazard ratio of 1.9, although it showed no association with CKD. Coming to CKD and renal scarring, there is no association.
Last 1 minute to go.
There is no association of CKD seen in various studies, and various patients who have been followed post the procedure with DMSA or DTPA scan have shown no new incidence of renal scarring or loss of GFR post this procedure. So the take-home message being that it is an effective treatment for effective and a safe treatment for this child for this age group, and its broad spectrum of applicability still remains, even though the endoscopic techniques are taking over slowly and gradually. Thank you.
Vishwath, you can unshare your screen. I would like to,
Rahul, your audio is having a problem.
Now it's okay, sir.
Okay, but his question answer time starts with the first question only. See that?
Yeah, I would like to invite Dr. Mallikarjun, sir, to ask the first question.
Sir, unmute yourself, sir.
Sir, your audio.
Yeah. I just wanted to understand is about pediatric ESWL. How common you do pediatric ESWL nowadays in your institute?
Sir, the incidence is less. We have in the last 6 months, we have done 8 cases this year. Since January, we have done 8 cases of pediatric case dual, where when we include the range of 16 years. So,
what is the reason why you are preferring it less now? If at all you want one answer to be given, what is the reason why you don't prefer much?
Sir, it's not that we are preferring less. There are two things. Once we give options of endoscopic treatment and ESWL and explain the rate of that's, although the success rate is high, but their stone-free rate is less as compared to endoscopic procedures. Most patients go with the choice of having to get the stones cleared once in one go. So that is one reason, sir.
Okay. Any more? Want me to ask or?
Yes, you can ask one more question, sir.
No, you can go ahead. I think I can ask one more question.
Can I ask Dr. Ansari, sir, to ask a question?
Dr. Vishrut, I am audible to you.
Yes, sir.
Sir.
Just tell us about something. What is the correlation of pediatric lithotripsy in terms of body mass index and anatomical anatomy of the kidney? And listen carefully. I am asking two things: body mass index and the anatomy of the calyces and the lithotripsy outcome.
Sir, body mass index can be considered as a surrogate marker for stones to skin distance. So considering that stones to skin distance, as we know, is an important factor to predict the effectivity of ESWL. So in pediatric ESWL, this is less, the stone to skin distance is less. Therefore, it is one of the reasons that it has a higher success rate as compared to adults. So for the second part of the question, the calyceal anatomy is important. While considering the this modality as a treatment, as various factors are important, like the infundibular width, infundibular pelvic angle in cases of lower calyceal stones, which have to be taken into consideration while considering this therapy.
Which you have to tell me specifically the length of infundibulum and the infundibular pelvic angle.
Sir, infundibular pelvic angle more acute the angle, less is the success. So
you have to tell me the cutoff. This is well understood. Even the MS general surgery student will tell us. Lesser the angle, lesser will be the clearance.
45 degrees with infundibular length of 4 mm.
4 mm. Infundibular length of 4 mm. Just think over it.
No. Infundibular width of less than 4 mm. Sir, length... length.
No problem. Back to Dr. Rahul.
Yeah. Malikarjun, sir, you wanted to ask the question.
What do you think that the incidence of lung injury, parenchymal injury because of ESWL, if at all you believe it, how do you protect it?
Sir, it is very rare, and it was seen in older versions of lithotripters, and therefore in older literature, it has been recommended to use lung shields for this to prevent such complications. But in newer lithotripter, this complication is even rarer, and currently there are no indications to regularly use such shields to prevent lung injury.
Any other question? Prasanna sir, you can ask.
So do you need to give anesthesia always? What is your protocol?
Sir, in
our last practice, 1 minute.
In our practice, for younger children, especially below 8 years, there is not a definitive cutoff, but we prefer general anesthesia. But for patients who are cooperative and older children, we use slight analgesia with sedation like midazolam or ketamine in our institute.
And what's your protocol? Do you stent them all, or
no,
you stent them only on need basis?
We do not practice pre-ESWL stenting, although other than the various recommendations here, we do stent patients with solitary kidneys or patients who have had who are expected to have infected stones with larger size.
Vishrut, you have a 1.2 centimeter pelvic stone in 2 year child. What will be your preferred modality in your institute?
1.2 centimeter.
1.2 centimeter renal pelvic stone in a 2 year child.
Sir, our preferred modality would be a ESWL because we don't have the luxury of mini or micro perk techniques.
No. Forget about that. You have all modalities available. Which will be your preference? for 1.2 centimeter renal pelvic stone in 2 year child. What you will prefer from your institutional practice, as well as from your knowledge, as well as from the whatever you have narrated right now?
Sir, my preferred option would be a mini PCNL or micro PCNL, micro PERC.
So your time is up. Go to the next. Thank you, Vishrut.
We'll go to the third presentation. That is by Dr. Sumit Agarwal. He's with his teacher, Dr. Swarnendu Mandal, and he'll be talking about proximal hypospadias with Cordy, single stage or two stage. He's from AIIMS, Bhubaneswar. You're not audible.
Good evening, sir. Am I visible?
You are visible and audible. You can go ahead.
Okay. Good evening, sir. My topic is proximal hypospadias with Cordy, single stage or two stage repair. At the end of this presentation, we will know about what are the various approaches to proximal hypospadias repair, what are the determinants of one or two stage repair, and what are the outcomes of these repairs. The options of one stage repair are snodgrass or tubularized incised plate repair, island tube hypospadias repair, onlay island flap technique, or Koyanagi repair. Bias flap is a two-stage flap repair. Stage tuberized auto graft or stag repair is a two-stage graft repair. Ulaanbaatar stage hypospadias repair. Snodgrass or a tip technique. In this, after a circumconural incision, penile degloving is done. The corpus spongiosum along the side of the urethral plate is dissected. If the urethral plate is good, and with no or minimal cautery and it is pliable, a midline relaxing incision is made, followed by tubularization over a catheter. Asopa in 1971 reported on a transverse pedicle flap utilizing the undersheath surface of the prepuce to replace the urethra. Entire prepucial skin was transferred with the skin tube. The major problem was this technique was penile torsion. Hodgson modified this technique by incising the prepucial skin on a tube and then leaving the newly constructed skin tube attached to the larger surface area of the incised prepucial skin. This decreased the chances of torsion if the prepuce were dissected up to penopubic angle. Duquet gave a technique of transverse prepucial island flap in which around 1.5 centimeter wide rectangular flap is prepared. This flap was tubularized over urethra and then a neo-urethra was formed. Tube onlay, inlay onlay, and onlay flap on tunica albuginea are the modifications of Duquet technique. Onlay island flap technique is used when the urethra is narrow and non-pliable, in which a transverse prepucial flap of appropriate size is taken and it is anastomosed over the urethra. Koyanagi or a modified Koyanagi repair is a versatile technique which can be used for severe Cordy correcting in a single stage. In this is the paramiatal marking of the paramiatal incision which is made, which is extended up to the inner prepuce. Then flaps are raised. If this flap is cut in the dorsal aspect, then it becomes a Koyanagi repair. And if it is not cut and this flap is brought on the ventral aspect, it is a Hayashi repair. After it is brought in the ventral aspect, this hole is closed, followed by tubularization of the tube and closure of the skin. If there is severe Cordy more than 30 degrees requiring multiple corporotomies, a two-stage repair is preferred. It is also an option in those requiring urethral transection. Bias flap is a two-stage hypospadias repair in which first the incisions are marked, degloving of the penis is done, dysplastic or Cordy tissue which is removed, followed by bias flap are developed by incising the dorsal inner prepucial skin in the midline to the mucosal collar, and the redundant of the dorsal skin is bring to the ventral aspect and fixed. Followed by, after 6 months, this a U-shaped Thiers Duplet incision is made for tubularization, urethroplasty is done, followed by glans and skin closure. Stage tubularized autograft repair or a stag repair was given in 2017 by Snodbush, and it is a modification of Braca repair. in which in stage one, first degloving of the penis is done, followed by complete mobilization of the urethra after cutting the urethra at coronal sulcus up to the membranous urethra. Three transverse corporotomies were made opposite to the maximum bend, followed by urethra was pulled distally as much as possible and fixed to the corpora, and the space between the urethral plate and on the corpora up to the glans was grafted with an inner preputial graft and was quilted. After 6 months, this tube was tubularized, followed by scrotoplasty and penile skin closure. So overall outcomes, which are in terms of complication rate, were around 23 to 68% on various studies. If it is a mild proximal penile hypospadias, TIP repair gives a very good repair. But if it is a severe proximal hypospadias, TIP or only repair gives around 25% of the complications, and these were similar in both. Recurrent penile curvature were less with two-stage repair, and bias two-stage flap repair has a variable outcome of a complication rate of 30 to 70% along different studies. This study told that, which came in 2013, which told that urinary complications were similar across the groups, although two-stage repair provide longer penis with a better cosmetic outcome. Koyanagi and Hayashi technique had a complication rate similar of 61%, although Hayashi technique seems to provide a better distal blood supply to the reconstructed urethra. SAG repair corrected penile curvature in around 77% of the patients at one go, increasing to 98% with three operations, and overall reported complications were also around 25% or less. So the data on direct comparisons of these studies, these techniques and long-term outcomes are still lacking. So in a case of proximal hypospadias with CORDI on an operation table, penile degloving and artificial erection is done, followed by if CORDI is resolved, then we can directly go for one-stage repair. Although if it is a persistent CORDI and it is less than 30 degree and urethral plate is well preserved, we can do a dorsal plication and go for one-stage repair. In a healthy urethra, we can go for a Snodgrass repair, or in an unhealthy urethra, we can go for an only repair. Although if there is a severe CORDI or in mild CORDI, urethral plate is not healthy, then we can go for corporal lengthening with urethral cutting. Or in this, for one-stage repair, there's a tuberized flap repair or a Koyanagi repair, or we can go for two-stage repairs. Two-stage repair are more preferred because they have less complications. So there are various approaches. Surgeon's choice is according to his expertise and preference. For one-stage repair, CORDI is less than 30 degree and good urethral plate, then we can do a one-stage repair. Reported results are similar by different approaches.
Last 1 minute.
Comparing studies are available. So concluding with this presentation, best surgical technique for proximal hypospadias repair is yet to be established. Although we have progressed a long way in decreasing the urethroplasty complications and improving outcomes, further studies are required to establish the best surgical procedure. Thank you.
Thank you, Sumit. Doc, you can share your screen.
Yes, sir. 1 minute.
Dr. Amilal, sir, is there? Yes. Sir, I'll request you to start the question and answer.
Thank you, Dr. Hoko. I think I'll put first question. What are the plate preservation procedures in single stage?
Plate preservation without cutting.
Plate preservation, you see, in hypospadiology, plate preservation is preferred.
Yes, sir.
What are the plate preservation procedures in hypospadias?
It is a
proximal hypospadias, you can say.
It is a tubularized incised plate urethroplasty. A Thiers Duplet technique is also used. The only difference is if the incision is not given in between, then only technique only island preputial island flap is a plate preserving technique?
Okay, anyway.
That's it.
Okay. How will you correct the curvature in plate preserving procedures and in plate transecting procedures?
In plate preserving procedures, a dorsal plication is preferred. First is complete degloving. Degloving corrects, in many cases, degloving corrects the curvature. If degloving does not correct the curvature, then we can do a dorsal plication. Some people have also told about lifting up the urethra from the corpora, although this decreases the vascularity and increased chance of stricture formation. In a urethral plate cutting procedure, there are multiple things. First is degloving of the penis, followed by cutting of the urethral plate at the corona. Complete mobilization of this urethra can be done up to the membranous urethra. If after this also cordy is persisting, we can do ventral corporotomies, and that is corporal lengthening procedure in which a single incision can be given from 4 to 8 o'clock position, or Snodgrass defined about 3 corporotomies which are given at 4 millimeter distance, or there is something known as mild cuts which does not cut through the tunica albuginea. These are known as fairy cuts which can be done. After this also, if this is not corrected, then we can do a dorsal plication.
Okay. May I ask one more?
Yes, yes.
What is the commonest complaint of the parents as well as of patient of late term in hypospadias repair?
Of late term?
What is the commonest complaint of the parents or the patient after hypospadias repair?
The urethra, the glands is not normal. There's something wrong with the glands. And the urethra is, urethra is not good. He is voiding from a proximal mia.
How the parents will know urethra or not? The commonest complaint.
They were telling about the curvature of the penis, basically. Penis is small and curved.
Penis is small. That is the curve.
Okay.
Yes. Go ahead with the other.
We'll request Dr. Chandra Singh to ask the question.
Sir, just a minute, sir. My battery.
Minu, don't count this time from his.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Sumit, mentioned after corporotomy, it was a good presentation. After corporotomy, you said you would do dorsal plication. How would you assess adequate correction of cordy after corporotomy?
So it is at each stage we have to do artificial erection.
Yes, that so after corporotomy, how will you do artificial erection?
Last 1 minute.
After corporotomy, we'll again clamp at the base of the penis, insert a butterfly needle and inject saline.
Your fluid will retain or it will leak from somewhere? And from it will leak.
It will leak from the corporotomy.
Okay,
there.
Fine. So
how will you assess?
Second question. What is the commonest problem with you mentioned about Koyanagi? You showed a beautiful picture. What is the commonest complication for which modified Koyanagi is mostly given up?
Urethroplasty complications, as in
Koyanagi, modified Koyanagi. You mentioned about modified Koyanagi.
Urethroplasty complications like in diverticulum formation.
Yes. Okay. Thank you. Dr. Rahul, back.
Ansari,
sir.
5 minutes over.
Ansari, sir, would you like to ask the last question? Sir, you are mute.
Sir, if the time is permitted, I would like to ask
final question. Can you be loud, sir?
Sir, your voice is.
Hello. Can you tell the difference between the ASOPA and the ducket?
Sir, ASOPA did not mobilize the preputial flap. he kept that prepucial fat attached to the prepucial skin. Although this Duquette had mobilized it on a complete pedicle flap, and then he tubalized it and sutured it. So as he take the entire skin along with the along the shaft of the penis, it led to more of distortion.
All right. So back to Dr. Rahul.
Yeah. Okay. We his time is also over. We'll go to the next presentation. I would like to invite
Rahul. Give some time to mark the score to the judges.
We'll give 30 seconds.
Yeah. Have some break.
Yes. Yes.
We can have some little bit comment from Dr. Ansari. Sir,
yes, sir.
Have some comfortable comments.
Actually, with this hypospadiastopic is very close to hearts of most of the surgeons who are doing pediatric urology or pediatric surgeons, and everybody almost has a dream in his life to do a flawless surgery. But somehow, many a times we all burn our fingers, and one of the best surgeries done on the OR table have proven to be the greatest disaster in our hands. Right. And I think Dr. Amil Albert and Dr. Mallika Arjun will laugh and definitely acknowledge this.
No doubt about it. No doubt about it. What you predict and what you see after 15 days are entirely different.
Entirely.
The majority of the surgeries, yes, it is always said what looks good should heal good. That is not necessarily true in hypospadias. It may look great there. Oh, it may not look the same pay after 15 days.
Right. Absolutely. Absolutely.
May I make one comment?
Yes, sir.
Please, sir.
You see, I'll share my this experience. All surgeons, the person of hypospadia surgery who is comfortable at table and you yourself is satisfied, then chances of having a very good result. So you have to be satisfied on the table by your own work.
Go ahead with the next presentation. Thank you, sir.
Go ahead with the next presentation. I would like to, Dr. Ajit, can you, Dr. Ajit Gojela, along with his teacher, Dr. Samir Swain, is going to present on fallacies in rhinogram with example. He's presenting from SCB Medical College, Cuttack.
Sir, it is visible, sir. It's visible.
You're visible and audible.
Okay, sir. So, good evening, everyone. The use of nuclear medicine in pediatric urology has expanded and is commonly indicated for assessment of obstruction, renal function, or effects of the UTI on the upper tract in case of VUR. So, here, I, Dr. Ajit Gujela, today with my faculty, Dr. Samir, sir, will be presenting some fallacies in rhinogram with examples. So rhinography is mainly of two types, the static and the dynamic. Static, where we use the technetium 99 label DMSA and evaluate the morphology and function, and the dynamic, where we use technetium 99 label DTPA, MAC3 or EC and evaluate the relative function and drainage. First, we will see the fallacies in the DMSA scan or the statical or the static scintigraphy. So the first fallacy is considering normal variants to be some pathology. Normal variants occur quite normally, and they can be different orientations of the kidney axis, hyperactive ports, fetal lobulation, or others. For example, in this case, what we see is the in the left kidney in the posterior view, the upper pole is hypoactive, whereas when seen in another view, that is left posterior oblique view, it appears to be normal. Similarly, another normal variant is a fetal lobulation seen here. So what we have to do is we have to assess the kidney in all the possible views. Secondly, whenever we see any abnormal morphology, we need to rule out the common variants. The second fallacy is motion artifact, which commonly occurs when the kid moves on the table, as a result of which it alters the image quality, affects the detection of small focal renal scars, and also there's a need to repeat imaging. What we need to do is we need to assure the give assurance to the child with the patient near the child, as it is an open gantry. In case of skilled radiographers, there is no need of sedation, and use of motion correction software helps. The next fallacy is high background activity, which is typically seen in case of impaired renal function, wherein the tracer renal uptake is significantly reduced, as a result of which there is high background activity, which means there is low signal when high noise. There is low signal to noise ratio, which is typically seen when there is renal immaturity, chronic renal failure, or renal dysplasia, and it affects the evaluation of function and morphology. As here, in a five-year-old boy, in case of bilateral renal dysplasia, there is high background activity. Similarly, in case of 3-week old baby due to renal maturity, there is high background activity which affects the evaluation of function as well as morphology. So whenever there's impaired renal function, be cautious in assessment. And while doing a dynamic scan in case of impaired renal function, we need to go to the EEG agents, tubular agents like MAC3 and EC. Ectopic kidneys. The palsy in ectopic kidneys occur because the position of the ectopic kidney, the depth from the gamma camera is different, as a result of which there is difference in attenuation, resulting in errors in evaluation of straight function. As seen here, in the DMS and posterior view, the left kidney appears to be better functioning than the right, whereas in the anterior view, the right kidney appears to be better functioning than the left. So the solution is to use a dual head gamma camera situated anteriorly, posteriorly, and then to take a geometric mean to assess the function. Also, in case of cross-fused ectopia, using three-dimensional imaging such as SPECT scan or low-dose CT helps. Contamination of tracer can occur at the centers, so it should be provided, or otherwise it will take the tracer to unnecessary organs, as seen here when a bactericidal fluid was added, as a result of which contamination occurred and kidney and spleen were seen. Next, we go to the palaces which are present in the dynamic radionucleotide dynography, which is more common. So the first palacy we'll study is the extravasation of the tracer. The tracer is generally given IV in a bolus form. However, when there's extravasation, it will cause continuous absorption of tracer, resulting in error in renogram curve, suggesting delayed uptake and delayed washout. It can be assessed by taking a short image over the injection site. So here, what we see is that in the initial minute 1, 2, 3, there is no activity seen in kidney because not enough amount of tracer is reaching the kidney. And also here, the curve is slowly rising. This is a fallacy typically seen with extravasated tracer injection. So better is to place an IV cannula, which will also help in injecting furosemide and will prevent an extravasation. The second is palsy due to position of the child. In this case, for example, with CVS scoliosis, patient has undergone spinal surgery and he's lying down on the bed in such a way that his left side of the body is more closer to the gamma camera, as a result of which left side kidney is more visible as compared to right, as a result, due to which the right kidney function as well as drainage cannot be assessed. So this is a pitfall due to opposition. Best is to have a comfortable lying child supine, which also reduces motion artifacts and avoid depth difference of more than 1 centimeter between the two kidneys. Reassessment following papilloplasty. Palsies can occur if we do a DTP too soon after doing papilloplasty surgery, which may sometimes give a false impression of persisting obstruction due to the renal pelvis being edematous and stable. Reasonable time interval is 4 to 6 months after surgery. So here is a case of a 12-year-old boy who has undergone left papilloplasty for left PUJ. The first scan is the MAC3 scan, which shows the right kidney good. Left kidney, there is hydronephrosis with a relative function of 18%. Then when the DTP scan was repeated after 5 weeks of papilloplasty surgery, here the right kidney is still well, but the left kidney still shows impaired function. However, when done after 6 months, the left kidney is showing improved function, which is almost about relative function has gone up to 40% from 18%. So appropriate timing of assessment of post-surgery by renogram is important. And secondly, you should be uniform in the radiopharmaceutical which we use prior to surgery and after surgery for reassessment. Now, the most important thing to assess in DTP is the transit time. We use the transit time as a factor to note whether the drainage is occurring or not. So it depends on mainly two factors, which is collecting system volume, which in turn is dependent on the volume of the hydronephrosis or the volume of the pelvis. And it is the transit time is inversely related to the uroflow rate, which is in turn dependent on renal function, hydration, bladder status, effect of gravity, and diuretic. So first, the size of the renal collector system. If the size of the renal collector system is very large, what it will do, it will cause a bathtub effect or reservoir effect, wherein the tracer which will get accumulated in the pelvis itself and not flow down through the ureter into the bladder. Also, it causes inaccurate background activity calculation and subtraction. And large kidney can also significantly extend anteriorly. So the counts which are from the more anterior portion of the parenchyma won't be received well by the gamma camera and resulting in attenuation. So here is an image, a DTP image, which shows of a right hydronephrosis, which is unobstructed. Here, the left kidney is functioning well. The right kidney, after giving furosemide, shows a classical type 3B curve. So furosemide administration alone may not be sufficient. Change of posture and postward images help. F-15 protocol also helps. In poor renal function, there will be errors in evaluation of drainage as it will pure poor response to the diuretic stimulus. Also, the background activity will be more. This is a typical case of poor renal function where background activity is high. There is holdup of dye in the pelvis because not enough amount of tracer is coming out of the pelvis to drain down. The new parameters like output efficiency and NURA can be used in poor renal function, and we should substitute DTPA for MAC3 whenever we are doing a scan in a patient with impaired function. Poor hydration, typically when in the case of poor hydration, what we see is holdup of dye in bilateral pelvis, which will give a false impression that it might be a bilateral PUGO, but on USG, what we see is that there is no hydronephrosis. So additional oral fluid is given, and in case of unilateral hydronephrosis, if there's no tracer in the bladder at 20 minutes, suspect hydration. The last is bladder status. Empty bladder helps because it reduces the pressure differential. Bladder outline may sometimes overlap the kidney ROI, and a patient may need to avoid during the surgery, making it technically unsatisfactory. This is a typical case wherein the bladder is overlapping the right kidney ROI, as a result of which the renal curves are very spurious. So you have to ask the patient to avoid before surgery and use a drainage catheter if necessary. In summary, I would like to say that well-hydrated, calm child in supine position is ideal. Ask to avoid before surgery or catheterize if needed. IV cannula and F0 protocol in pediatric patient acts very good. Normal renal variants and ectopia in case of while doing DMSA scan. Timing of the scan is also an important factor. Impaired renal function or gross hydronephrosis, take the result with a pinch of salt. And qualitative analysis, looking at curves, images is very important. Images don't lie, figures might lie. That's it. Thank you, sir.
So I would like to invite now Dr. Gyanin sir to ask the question first.
Ajit, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. You mentioned about the reservoir effect when assessing a PUGO obstruction.
Yes, sir.
So a couple of questions. Do you think T half values are an accurate indicator of denoting obstruction?
No, sir. T half values are not a very good indicator because what the SSMN, which is Society of Nuclear Medicine, has, they have said that more than 20 T half is to be taken as obstructed. But the underlying condition is that the kidney pelvis is normal, the kidney function is normal. So in those cases in which there is a reservoir effect, T half doesn't give you much information. On the other hand, post micturition images and the new parameters like the output efficiency and NORA are better here.
What are the values you mentioned about output efficiency and NORA?
Yes, sir.
What are the values of NORA which might indicate obstruction? And can you give your comments regarding the efficacy of NORA versus output efficiency?
Okay, sir. Both the parameters are highly advocated by the EANM, which is European Association of Nuclear Medicine. NORA is the normalized residual activity, which is wherein any activity over a minute of one in the curve is compared to the initial 1 to 2 minute activity, wherein the activity in the renal is maximum. So they have divided into three types. When the drainage is good, it is less than 0.5. When it is intermediate, 0.5 to 1.8. And when it is poor, it is more than 1.8. Now going to the output efficiency, it is the percentage of the renal activity, percentage of activity or the radio tissue which has left the kidney. So it is also advocated by EANM, and more than 80 is considered to be good. 80 to 60 is considered to be intermediate. Less than 60 considered poor. The advantages of these two are that the poor renal function does not really affect them. Secondly, they are very consistent. So doing a study in the different places and getting these parameters, we can compare it quite easily. And thirdly, they are also not affected much by the various F0, F15, F-15 or F20 protocol.
Can I ask one question more, Rahul?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. If you have to choose between output efficiency and NORA, with your genogram center, sir. Which one would they prefer and which one would you prefer?
Sir, to be true, we don't have any Nora or OE software here. But what the books say is that Nora is to be slightly better than the output efficiency.
Okay, and suppose your Renogram center is not doing either of the two. What are the variations in calculating the T-half, which might help you in differentiating obstruction from a non-obstructed system?
Okay, sir. There are some variations, some very interesting. For example, at 20 minutes, the activity divided by the max activity, which should be less than 30 for normal. And also in post void images, the post void activity remaining in the pelvis divided by the highest activity in the pelvis. These are the other ratios which we can obtain easily. And examine whether the drainage is occurring well or not.
Okay.
Can I invite Anil Dadwani, sir?
Rahul, I think you go first to the Dr. Ansari, and then if the time left, I will ask Professor Ansari.
Okay. Ansari, sir.
Oh, yes, Dr. Ajay, just tell us, can a reflux affect the outcome in a real scan?
Yes, sir.
I'll give one example.
Sir, for example, what the reflux does is that whenever there is the downward slope or the excretory phase, in case of reflux, it will give you a spike. This typically occurs. It gives a upward spike, and in such cases of UR, a catheter placement is important. And if it is not done, what it happens? It adds to the activity of that kidney, as the radio tracer from the bladder, due to UR, is going into the kidney to add into the activity and give us spurious curves.
What is the name of that spike? This is a half answer.
Sir, Holmes's sign is there.
All right. Back to Dr. Rahul.
Anil, sir, would you like
Prasanna,
to ask?
Sir. Prasanna, you ask question.
A child with bilateral PUJ block.
Yes, sir.
What is the difficulty in a diuretic renogram?
Sir, whenever there is a bilateral PUJ block, but the bilateral pelvis will hold the tracer, and there will be limited or no amount of tracer going into the bladder, which will give us a suspicion whether this patient is hydrated or not. And more commonly, in case of bilaterally affected kidney, the renal function which may be affected, which will lead to higher background activity, which will again give us curves which would be spurious.
If the creatinine is normal, what is the difficulty, technical difficulty in interpreting the study? Because on a practical term, you need to determine whether both sides are obstructed or one side is obstructed. If so, which is more, which side you will operate first, etc., etc.
Sir, if both sides are obstructed and it is generally a bigger obstruction, the ROI curves are also very difficult to be drawn. And then you need to distribute the ROI curves into two parts. And there is a concept of whole kidney curve, then there's a concept of cortical curve, there's a concept of pelvic curves. So typically using cortical curves in this case would help you in assessing of relative function far more better than using the whole curve.
So his time is up now. You can go ahead with the marking. And then,
judges.
Yeah. Chandra would like to have some observations. Want to make some comment, Chandra? Chandra, quick comment while
yes.
he's. Yeah, okay, fine. If you are busy, we can ask.
Yes, I believe that it is so crucial to be aware of the pitfalls when it comes to making a decision about intervention, because as such, if we label a child as having an obstruction, we may wrongly subject, because the number of fallacies are so many, and it's good to be aware of them to avoid operating an unnecessary child. And I would again highlight on the need for a delayed imaging, which often gets missed because logistically it is difficult for the center to bring the baby back and put them on the counter and all that. So we need to be aware of that.
And another request to the presenters is that take questions, you know, don't hurry up answering that questions, right? Give answer comfortably. Take your own time. You will get the adequate, you have adequate time. You will be able to answer comfortably. So don't try to accelerate your speed, and that can cause a little bit of a problem. So with that, all the best to next candidate, and Rahul, you can announce.
I now invite Dr. Amit Sharma, and he's coming with his teacher, Dr. Sabyasachi Pandey sir. He'll be talking about tip versus graft tip to repair distal hypospadias in a narrow urethral plate. He's presenting his college, HCB Medical College, Cuttack. Dr. Amit?
Sir. Am I audible, sir?
You're audible. Yeah.
My slide is visible, sir?
Yes, your slides are visible.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Amit Kumar Sharma from SCB Medical College. And my mentor today is Dr. Sabyasachi Panda. My topic is tip versus graft tip to repair distal hypospadias in narrow urethral plate. Introduction, the Snodgrass described the tip repair technique for hypospadias in 1994 as a means to widen and improve the mobilization of urethral plate. This technique is the modification of Thiers-Duplay repair, in which the midline incision is given. The indication are distal hypospadias, proximal hypospadias whenever the ventral cordy is less than 30 degree, reoperation in cases of urethral plate, whenever urethral plate is maintained and there is no gross scar. Now this is a picture depicting tip repair. Initially we give a circumcision incision followed by degloving, and the incision are given along the visible junction of the glans wing to urethral plate. Incision of urethral plate extending to the near underlying corpora, then followed by tubularization of urethral plate from distally to the proximally. Note that the first stitch is around 3 mm proximal to the end of the plate, creating oval opening. The new urethra is covered with dartus flap. Glansplasty is creating new meatus and counting down to the corona. And repair and circumcision is completed. The advantages are improved appearance of the meatus, creating a vertical slit neomeatus, better cosmosis. Complications include fistula, meatal stenosis, and urethral stricture. Now the graft tip. In 2000, Colon and Gonzel reported a new technique of one-stage urethroplasty with a dorsal inlay graft using inner prepucial skin. This technique involves incision from the native meatus to the end of glans, not to the end of urethral plate, with placement of dorsal graft. Now, this is a diagram depicting graft tip repair, which is very similar to the tip repair. The only difference here is that we are harvesting the prepucial graft, and this graft is placed over the incised urethral plate's raw surface. The mechanism of healing of the incised plate is debatable. Snodgrass postulated that healing occurs by re-epithelization with no evidence of new urethral stenosis or stricture formation. Other consideration that it heals by epithelial creeping, which theoretically increases the incidence of complication because of healing by primary intention is allowed to contract. Advantages are grafting allow immediate coverage with epithelium and minimizes the fibrous reaction in the incised urethral plate bed, decreased incidence of stenosis and fistula. It yields an ample new urethral wall for a potential secondary repair without adding grafting related problem if failure occurs. Now question arises, when to graft? There is an algorithm given by Tariq O. Abbas, in which he measured the urethral plate pre-incision and the urethral plate post-incision. And he calculated the urethral plate ratio. If the urethral plate ratio is more than 0.5, then we should go for tip repair. If the urethral plate repair is less than 0.5, then we should go for a graft tip repair. There is another scoring tool, that is plate objective scoring tool. in which A point A is a distal midline mucocutaneous junction. Point B is glenular knob, where the mucosal edges of urethral plate edges changes its direction. And C is glenular coronal junction. Now, whenever the AB to BC ratio is less than 1.2, then we should go for dorsal inlet tip repair. If this ratio is more than 1.2, then we should go for tip repair, or we can go for tuberalization. Now, there are many studies I have gone through. There are many studies which are in favor of graft repair, and there are many recent studies which are favoring the Snodgrass technique. Now, I will start with a favorable study. In Journal of Pediatric Urology in 2015, there was one study which states that is a combined inner preputial inlay graft with tuberalized incised plate in hypospadias repair worth doing. This was a prospective study which included 230 cases, and they concluded that combined inner preputial graft with tip urethroplasty secure the optimal granular position of wide slit-like neomatous because of extension of incision beyond the end of the plate, thus optimizing functional and cosmetic outcome with no metal stenosis. Now, the studies against the graft repair, which include the study done in 2020, and it was published in Journal of Pediatric Urology. This study states that Snodgrass versus Snodgraft operation to repair the distal hypospadias in the narrow urethral plate. This was a prospective randomized study which included 60 patients, and they concluded that the operation time was longer in graft group as compared to Snodgrass group, and with a comparable outcome. The Snodgraft procedure is not superior to Snodgrass operation in narrow healthy urethral plate. And there is another study in Journal of Pediatric Urology published in 2017, and it was published by Dr. Warren Snodgrass. And it was took at least 224 cases, and they concluded the urethral plate bit before incision did not increase urethroplasty complication. Surgeon do not need to measure or categorize the urethral plate to determine suitability for tip repair, as long as the plate incision is made deeply to the corpora. Now, there is another study published in Journal of Pediatric Urology in 2020, which states that, comparing the outcome of tuberalized incised plate urethroplasty and dorsal inlay graft urethroplasty in children with hypospadias, a systemic review and meta-analysis. In this study, they took two randomized control trials, two prospective trials, and two retrospective studies. And they concluded that there is no strong evidence to suggest that either technique offer more favorable outcome until more robust randomized trial exists. Decision regarding the appropriate repair should be based on the surgeon experience and outcome. Now, proponent of the G-tip technique often argue that grafting the incised plate improves healing of reconstructed urethra, resulting in wide caliber lumen and better urinary flow parameters. They also argue that this would allow better positioning of meatus at the tip of the glands, a site often vulnerable to stenosis with improved cosmosis. And now, conclusion and implication for clinical practice. There is no strong evidence to suggest that either of the tip or G-tip technique offer more favorable outcomes. Although many authors claim that one technique may be superior to other, there are no robust randomized controlled trials. Until such trial exists, decision regarding the appropriate repair will continue to be based on the surgeon's preference and experience. However, surgeons should be aware of small potential for increased complication following tip repair. Thank you.
Rahul, you unmute yourself, Rahul. Rahul.
Yes. Now I am audible.
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Malik, sir, can you ask the first question?
Sir, unmute yourself. Malik, sir, unmute yourself.
Malik, unmute. Sir, you unmute yourself. Sir,
unmute yourself.
No. I have some emergency in the theater. Call me. So I just need to go. Excuse me on this. You just go ahead with your testing, please. Sorry. Okay.
So I'll request Dr. Ramilal, sir, to please start the question.
Hello.
Do you think that incision is required in all cases of hypospadia, distal hypospadias repair?
No, sir. If the glans is well grooved, then there is no need to give the incision, sir.
Is it the glans only?
Glans or urethral plate, sir.
So, how will you measure that urethral plate is adequate?
Sir, if after putting the catheter, if the urethral plate is easily approximable, then we can go for that.
What size of catheter?
8 French, sir.
8 French for all?
Mostly we give 6 French catheter for smaller kits. And for bigger kits, 8 French can
suppose
be given.
If a child is of 6 months, the other one is of 4 years, then is the same
six French, age? 6 French is best, sir.
For all?
Yes.
Okay. How yes. will you decide the depth of the incision?
Sir, depth of incision should be till the surface of corpora, sir. The corpora surface should be clearly visualized. Sir.
In all cases?
Yes, sir. In all cases, according to the Snodgrass, it should be till the surface of the corpora. Sir. In many papers, he stated that.
So, is there any method of measuring the urethral plate exact? Whether it is the urethral plate is wide, narrow. Is there any method for the age and the child? Okay, go ahead. You can go ahead, Rahul.
I have one quick question, Amit. You have an 8 or 10 month child sir. With a narrow urethral plate where you feel that if you go ahead with the repair, you will need the GTIP,
sir.
Right? Graft TIP. And do you think that waiting for another 2 years will make any difference and you will get away with this only TIP? Is there any that kind of a correlation is there?
No, sir. No, sir. It's better to do surgery within 16 months, sir. It is always preferable.
What exactly you are doing in your institute?
Sir, we are doing tip repair, sir. Most of the cases, we are doing tip repair.
But if you have a narrow urethral plate, right, which is just of a, say, 5 French feeding tube size, just, right? Then what you will
case,
do?
In that case, also, we are going for tip repair only, sir. Okay. If it is if the size of glans is smaller than 14 mm, sir, or the urethral plate is very narrow, that is less than 4 mm or 3 mm, then only we give a graft repair.
That is what exactly asked, that if you have a 5 French only, the urethral plate. Yeah? Okay, Dr. Ansari, you ask your question. And thereafter, one question from the Chandra. Quickly.
Okay, Dr. Amit.
Sir.
Yes, you just tell me, have you seen DVIU? Internal optical urethrotomy.
Sir, kindly repeat the question, sir, please.
Internal optical urethrotomy for stricture urethra.
Yes, sir. I've seen that.
Yes?
Yes, sir.
And you tell us the difference between, in TIP also, we are doing a dorsal urethrotomy.
Sir.
In DVIU also, we are doing dorsal urethrotomy.
Yes,
what
sir.
Is the basic difference between the two? Why one forms a stricture, restricture? Why Snodgrass say there is no stricture?
Sir, actually, in cases of Snodgrass repair, the urethral plate is healthy. There is no scarring. But in cases of stricture urethra, which is already scarred, the healing will not occur properly, sir. In cases of Snodgrass, the epithelium will take over and repair that.
That area, sir.
That is not the correct, yes. What is the basic difference between the healing process of the two?
Sir, I am Dr. Sabesh Panda, sir. I'll answer this question. In case of, sir, what basic difference between DVIU and this tip is, in tip, the healing process is by epithelialization, whereas in case of DVIU, it is basic because of granulation tissue and fibrosis, which leads on the healing process. So in DVIU, it is the granulation and the scar, whereas in case of TIP, it is the re-epithelialization. That's the basic difference.
Back to Dr. Rahul.
Yeah, Chandra, sir.
Yeah, so my question to you is, what is the effect of testosterone or HCG on the width of the plate?
Sir, Sir, testosterone and SCG actually increases the size of glands, and it also increases the new vascularization of that plate, sir, which may aid in healing.
So will that replace grafting in that case?
No, sir.
Can you avoid grafting?
No, sir.
Thank you.
So by the time we'll give 30 seconds for the judges, can I request Gyanen sir to make the final comment?
Well, hypospadias is, if I have to make an analogy with cricket, in the olden days, it used to be that if you want to play a classical cover drive, you should follow 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 steps. And later on, the new set of players came who could hit the ball through the cover, but they would not follow that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But the result was the same. So it's the same holds true for hypospadias. Some surgeries work very well in the hands of some people. Some surgeries do not do so well. So I think the answer, which particular surgery would do is the best, will never be answered, because this would always be subjective. And probably not in my lifetime, I expect an answer to come on this aspect.
A quick question for both our experts, Ansari sir and Milalpat sir. Sir, in your practice, how frequently you do graft TIP and what exactly your indication? Amilalpat sir, first you. Quick answer, sir. Sir, unmute yourself, sir.
I put an adequate size, the proximal urethra. I measure the urethral plate by putting a stent in the proximal healthy urethra and then measure the urethral plate how much. In most of the cases where you can tubularize the urethral plate without incision, that is the first choice. Then,
so how exactly, sir, you measure?
You see, you take infant feeding tube of 5 French, 6 French, 7 or 8, and usually you know that if the child is more than 2 years, you need 6 French.
Sir, any such normogram is existing which is asking, instructing us that as per this age, you have to have this much of caliber urethra must. Is there any normogram, such normogram is available? Comparing the age with the size of the urethra, which we have to compulsory construct, or no, it is just a kind of a subjective thought process. Sir, unmute yourself, sir.
Sir, unmute you.
But sir,
yes. You see, this I have published this one, the urethral plate, width of the urethral plate and development of the spongiosum. These are two together. When you will have to consider these two things, you will have to consider. So when you are putting that one, first one, as I told you, that gives simple incision without incision. Second is the superficial incision. When you give superficial incision and you tubularize the urethral plate, no need to go for the graft. If I put a deep incision to tubularize that urethral plate, then I supplement with
the deep graft. Means exactly you are going up to the corpora. Deep,
yes,
what do you mean
deep,
by deep?
Okay. Deep is that is the
so reaching up to the reaching exactly up to the, you can say that what I understood, yeah, is that you are reaching to the corpora, that is considered the deep.
Then I put the graft. Another
answer is, sir, okay, your brief comment, sir. How frequently you do the graft as well as your indication, sir?
Yeah, visual inspection gives me some idea, but my true practice is I first assess the age of the child and designate a size of the catheter by 0.6 into age plus 6. This is the usual size of the urethra. This is our indigenous application. We have been using this equation for the last 10 years.
Sir, have you published this, sir?
Yes, I must be in one of the publication in Structure Urethra. It should be there, yes.
Okay.
And this size of the catheter. Now I give an incision. If it is easily coming over it, then I will do it TIP simply. If it is not coming to my equation, then I put a graft over it. That's only so that it can easily overcome it.
Perfect,
because
sir,
no parameters prior done, as Dr. Amilal said, it's not sacrosanct. Unless you rotate it, then only you come to know that we need to do put something on dorsally.
But still, I am very happy that at least you have given some objective idea that you can say 6 plus age. So if you, sir, having a 10 year of experience, then we would like you to publish, sir, that because probably to my mind,
it almost for the last 10 years we have been using this equation, and not only for hypospadias, for catheterization. Most of the time, stricture induced post catheterization, this equation is very useful. We send this equation to various wards also.
Okay, perfect. Rahul, you can go with the next presentation. Thank you.
We'll go to the last presentation. We'd like to invite Dr. Ankit Mishra. His teacher is Dr. Manoj Kumar. He'll be talking about urinary tract complication in myelomeningocele. He's presenting AIIMS Bhubaneswar. Dr. Ankit?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Are the slides visible, sir?
Yes, slides are visible. You're audible. Please go.
Okay. Good evening, respected teachers and my dear colleagues. I'll be talking about urinary tract complications in myelomeningocele. The learning objectives from this presentation would be to learn how to evaluate a patient presenting with myelomeningocele with a specific urological point of view, how to follow them up, when to decide to start treatment in these patients, and when to consider various surgical options, and what do the guidelines say. Initial evaluation of a patient with myelomeningocele, a meticulous history and a physical examination along with routine laboratory and urine analysis is done, specifically serum creatinine and serum cystatin C. Ultrasound is usually the first imaging modality that is performed to assess any upper tract changes in the form of hydronephrosis, hydrourethra, or any cortical thinning. This hydronephrosis can be graded according to the Society of Fetal Urology classification of hydronephrosis. Any abnormal voiding mechanic can also be known by an abnormal bladder wall thickness or an excessive post-void residue. The most important diagnostic tool in these patients is a urodynamic study. It comprises of the video urodynamics, including the voiding cystourethrogram, the cystometrogram, and the electromyogram. It assesses the risk of damage to the upper urinary tract in these patients. A voiding cystourethrogram will differentiate an at-risk bladder from a safe bladder by these points. There will be a small capacity bladder with a thick wall and trabeculations and a ureteric reflux. This would be a risky system. The cystometrogram and electromyogram will be used to calculate the filling and voiding pressures and also to look for any detrusor sphincter dysfunction if present. The EAU-ESPU guidelines say that the urodynamic study should be performed in each and every patient of spina bifida with a strong recommendation. These patients are then functionally classified into four categories. The first one being an overactive sphincter with an underactive detrusor. They have an unsafe system and usually they are made safe by introducing CIC, and antibiotics can be given if there are UTI. The second system, which is the most common, is the hostile bladder, in which there is overactive sphincter and overactive detrusor. This is due to detrusor sphincter dyssynergy, and these patients are better managed with a CIC and anticholinergics as the first option. The third category is the patient with an underactive detrusor and underactive sphincter. They have a safe system, but the only complaint is of leakage. So they may be offered dryness with CIC and later on may require an outlet surgery. The fourth category is that with an overactive detrusor, but an underactive sphincter. These can be managed with CIC and anticholinergics. The renal CT scan in the form of DMSA or MAC3 can be done the first year of life. They will evaluate the upper tract damage. Later on, they can be done in the follow-up when USG is showing some abnormal changes, unfavorable urodynamics, or incidence of recurrent febrile UTI is there. We'll see a scarring as a photogenic area on a DMSA scan. According to the CDC urology protocol for spina bifida patients, renal bladder ultrasound starting from birth at 3 days, then at 3 monthly for the first year, and then yearly for 5 years is preferred. The urodynamics in the form of video urodynamics is preferred at 3 months. If it is normal, then yearly up till 3 years, and then 2 to 3 yearly. Renal scan can be done once to evaluate in the first year the renal function. A lifelong follow-up has to be kept in these patients with a weak recommendation from the EAU guidelines. The goal of treatment in these patients is to preserve the renal function, prevent any upper tract deterioration, prevent development of urinary tract infections, and later in childhood to gain continence. So a proactive approach is preferred, in which the treatment is started as soon as the child is born. as compared to a reactive or expectant management when the bladder decompensation has already occurred. In proactive approach, clean intermittent catheterization started soon after birth causes decreased risk of renal complications later on, and also a less need for augmentation procedures. And even acceptance is better in patients when it is started early. A word of caution has to be given regarding latex allergies. CIC should be performed soon after birth in all spina bifida patients as a strong recommendation from EAU. Medical therapy, usually anticholinergics in the form of oxybutynin and tolterodine are FDA approved. They can be given in patients with overactive bladder or UDS. Beta-3 agonist and alpha blockers may have a role, but not come in mainstream recommendations. These patients may have asymptomatic bacteriuria, but this does not need treatment as it leads to resistance. The only indication for antibiotic is those having recurrent febrile UTI and a vesicoureteric reflux. Adequate bowel management has also been shown to decrease the risk of UTI, with EAU recommendation treating symptomatic urinary tract infections. A vesicoureteric reflux in these patients is usually secondary to bladder dysfunction. It predisposes to risk of pyelonephritis. So our aim should be to treat bladder dysfunction. Only in patients with a high-grade reflux and a low-pressure bladder, we can give a thought about retral reimplantation. Increasing the bladder capacity when the patient is resistant to treatment with CIC and anticholinergics can be first tried with a botulinum toxin. However, it is only useful in patients who have a compliant bladder with detrusor overactivity. If it is refractory to this, then the patients can be offered a bladder augmentation in the form of intestinal cystoplasty, a ureterocystoplasty, or a partial detrusectomy in the form of auto-augmentation. These patients have to be kept in a lifelong follow-up. The botulinum toxin has a level 2 evidence in its role in refractory patients, while augmentation has a strong recommendation. Lastly, patients who are having a persistent incontinence, in them, various procedures like an endoscopic bulking agent can be offered, but it causes reoccurrence is very high. A bladder neck sling surgery can be offered in female patients. An artificial urinary sphincter can be offered in patients who are dexterous enough to manage it. Bladder neck reconstruction can be offered. As a last resort in these leaking patients, a bladder neck closure with creation of a continent catheterizable stoma can be offered. In patients who are unable to do a CIC and are not fit for a bladder augmentation, we can offer some temporary solutions, like a urethral dilatation, which dilates the external sphincter, creation of a vesicostomy, creation of a cystostomy, and the creation of a reflexing retrocytostomy in patients who are having a high-grade reflux. These procedures will buy time for later on.
Last 1 minute.
So in conclusion, the preservation of the renal function is the main aim. We offer proactive management as compared to an expectant management. We should aim to achieve continence in patients in the childhood to make them independent, and these patients should be kept under rigorous follow-up as this bladder dysfunction is dynamic and may keep on changing up till end of life. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Ankit. I'll invite Dr. Prasanna sir to start the question first.
Can you name what are the three difficulties in initiating CIC in a newborn male child? I mean, it is an accepted, agreed fact that we need to do it. But on a practical possibility, what are the difficulties we encounter as caregivers, and how are we going to overcome that with the parents?
The first will be the apprehension of the parents regarding the need of the CIC and why it is necessary. So we'll have to educate the patients, the attendants, to regarding the need of the CIC and how it needs to be done and why it needs to be done. We can also offer a continence nurse, which can help them to perform CIC. Secondly, it has been seen that compliance is better if we start early. So an early start should be preferred, because later on the compliance is lesser in patients. And also if we start early, then they can do it independently at toilet training age after 3 to 4 years. They can do it independently. All the relevant precautions have to be explained along with the latex precautions.
How long do you think this takes to train the parents to do it?
Before the discharge, we try to train the patients to perform it at least 3 to 4 hourly. And we take care that before discharging, they are able to troubleshoot all the problems related to CIC. So usually a 1 to 2 week period is required before the discharge.
Right.
Ankit, according to you, which is the worst complication of a myelomeningocele so far, so urinary tract is concerned, or difficult to manage complication by the you as well as with the family?
Patient who has already developed a renal dysfunction, that is an irreversible complication. So that would be the most difficult complication and also the most common cause of death in these patients.
In a single sentence, how it could be avoided? If you have a child who is still not having a renal function deterioration, which is the best way in a couple of sentences you can avoid the renal impairment?
To use the proactive approach, using the clean intermittent catheterization and usage of anticholinergics and antibiotics as and when required.
So Chandra, next. And then quick answer from other experts. Chandra, you unmute
here. Yeah. How beneficial do you think is the early neonatal urodynamic evaluation?
Usually in an up till 1 year of age, the values are not very clear. There are no standardized values which can be taken. However, the CDC protocol tells it to be done at 3 months of age, but that has to be taken with a pinch of salt that it may not agree with our clinical conclusion. And so a clinical and an ultrasound finding would be get a higher preference in the first year of life. Later on, we can do depend on the UDS findings. And in the early year, again, the patient has to be pacified, has to be breastfed so he does not move. And sometimes some sedatives are may be used in these patients. So it is difficult to do in first year of age. And also there is leakage also because of the movement of the child, there will be leakage, which will lead to false values.
Thank you.
Ansari sir, would you like to ask a question?
Last 1 minute.
Gyanendra is there.
Gyanendra, yes.
Ankit, how would you follow up your patients so that you can diagnose the point where you can go for bladder augmentation?
The patients, if they are having a normal urodynamic finding, I would like to follow them up 3 monthly in first year. And then yearly follow-up is required. However, if they are showing the clinical symptoms of symptomatic UTI or any changes in the ultrasound in the upper tract, and clinically if the voiding pattern has changed, then I would like to do it more frequently.
Okay. Hello.
Hello.
Ankit, how can you avoid the recurrence of urine tract infection in this kind of a child? That is one of the difficult complications to manage.
5 minutes over.
Yes, sir. First thing will be that there will be retention of urine. So we'll have to do CIC, increase the frequency of CIC even to 1 to 2 hourly in patients who are having a cloudy urine or a foul smelling urine.
Do you have any cutoff of the number of frequency, the CIC in a child? For example, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, like that. Any cutoff that the child can be subjected?
I don't know, sir.
Ansari, sir, we wanted you to ask last question.
I just wondering, Ankit, your topic was the complications of meningomyelocele. But somehow you covered other things less on the complications. But you have to tell what are the risk factors for complications. Enumerate three most nasty risk factors leading to the complications in meningomyelocele or urinary tract system?
A bladder dysfunction is a thing that is seen in nearly all patients presenting with myelomeningocele. There is risk of renal function.
Bladder dysfunction to ho gayi wahan pe. What are the risk factors? What are the risk factors? Bladder dysfunction to has to be there when there is a meningomyelocele. What are the risk factors?
Risk factors for
what are the various urodynamic parameters which have been historically dangerous for upper tract?
Yes.
In meningomyelocele.
If the patient is having low compliance, less than 15 centimeter of water, having a detrusor leak point pressure more than 40 centimeter of water, and voiding pressure more than 80 centimeter of water, and at the time of filling, if there is a detrusor overactivity more than 15 centimeter of water, these can predispose to upper tract damage.
But this should have come into your presentation.
Ansari, yeah, go ahead. Your time is up, Rahul. Take some brief comments from the teachers or mentors who joined today. They can share their comments till the judges preparing their judgment.
Yes, so we have...
And with that, teachers, now once you finish with the teachers, ask our experts to make some comments. So next time when they come to the final, they come with the best possible preparations.
So we'll start with Ehsan sir. Is there? Dr. Ehsan, I think sir has left. So, Dr. Rohit is there. So, sir, unmute yourself.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Sir, tell us about your experience, how it went.
Actually, it is a very good experience, but unfortunately, there is a lot of rain. So, I was having a lot of interruption. But this is a very good experience, and the presentations were very precise, and I think every participant really put up their good effort to put up a nice show.
Okay, good, good. Dr. Manoj is there? I think majority has left.
Yes, sir, I'm here, sir. Rahul, sir.
Hi. Yes, sir. Sir, I was looking at your other screen.
Yeah. Okay. Good evening, sir. Good evening, experts. It's a really very nice initiative. Basically, what I feel ki these subspecialty particularly, these are ignored in many centers. And since we our USA is focusing on this particular subjects, it is a very interesting initiative, and so that other students and the experts and the teachers, whoever is involved in these issues, they will focus on these particular areas. And this should not happen that this pediatric urology will go to pediatric surgery, like our endourology, which was supposed to be on nephrology side, which was then kept in our side because of Smith, Dr. Smith. So, really, this is a great initiative from our USI education board.
Sir, actually, the basic aim is to inculcate and start getting an interest of the residents into the pediatric urology and the rest of the subspecialty. We would like you and everybody to request, irrespective of the result, to join us in as many number as possible for the final round. We wanted to have a strength of over 2,000 people. We have enough time, almost 15 days, for the final basically function to happen. Thanks very much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Dr. Swarnendu is there, or Dr. Sameer Swain?
I'm there.
Yes, yes, sir. Good evening, sir.
Good evening. I understand that we need to develop this pediatric urology, and that we need to make people encourage our under MCA students to read and do it. But the basic problem is, like, I am trained from BHU, I am trained from KGMC. There are very select few faculties in these units we were lucky enough to visit Ansari sir while we were in KGMC to go and learn pediatric urology from him. So the problem is not with our residents. The problem also lies with our training. And now, since I am interested in hypospadias, I keep doing it. My team in Bhubaneswar does it. So we are able to show it to our residents. But the problem is we were not fortunate enough with that level of training. And then the next thing that we are now trying to take up is we have this academic leaves, and we are trying to go to SGPGI to learn from Ansari sir, or some of us are even trying to go to Asopa sir and learning it. So again, this is a learning process. So it's not just a learning process for our residents. It's still a learning process for us, the budding generation of urologists, to pick up these things from our teachers. So yes, it's a good initiative in the right step, and we have to work together.
I think, sir, it is natural to get interested into the subspecialties where our teachers or our institute is focusing.
Yes.
But then once we come into the practice, the individual basically preference, and plus the patient's type which we are getting, that also demand us to further basically train ourselves. So would like to involve Dr. Samir if he's there.
Yes. Hello, good evening all. This is really a nice show. So to say, specifically discussing on a specific subspecialty in this wide forum, that means we are included all the zones. And probably there's a good number of participants throughout the country. And probably, what are the total numbers of participants?
Sir, we have 32 teams from all the zones. And the maximum we have reached is around 790. Okay. Today,
still a good, this is very good. Because the basic point of this training is, this is academic activities specifically focused to the residents. So at least our program should be oriented towards the new passed out urologists or the residents, so that the real technical advantage will be going on to them, rather than discussing on high-fi things and taking the technical superiority one after the another. We should discuss on basics, and we should discuss on whatever the new techniques towards that a residents or a fresh urologist can acquire. That's my point. And this is a really very good initiative. Thanks to Dr. Anil Taktwani and yourself, and thanks to USI also to start such a program. I'm really happy.
Thanks very much, sir. Dr. Sabyasachi Pandey, sir, is there. He would like to comment. I think no. And Dr. Ehsan, sir, is also not there. So I would like to now invite Dr. Arun Chawla, sir, to conclude the session. And then we'll follow by that the final comment by Rajiv, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Rahul. first of all, congratulations. Congratulations to begin with Dr. Rajiv TP, who conceptualized the program. Dr. Anil Taktwani and his team, including you and other team members, for executing the program. And it has been a great honor to be the part of this program on all the days of this interzonal competition. I don't know about the residents, but on personal front, it was a learning exercise for me, watching and listening the accomplished persons who are also a part of this program and who are doing work in the further subspecialty of pediatric urology, Dr. Abhilal Bhatt, Dr. Ansari, Dr. Shyam Joshi. There was much to gain from their comments also by being a part of this program. Number two, congratulations to all the participants and their mentors for putting up an excellent show. Overall, you can people who have walked the whole proceeding on the 5 days, the number of people who had participated, and the response it has got. I in my WhatsApp, at least I have
every day messages coming that this has been a very good program and this should be going to the other subspecialty. I told, just wait on it, it's coming. So overall, I am very excited now to watch the finale. And I think that will be very grand show. And I wish if we can cross these 1,000, 1,500 number on that. Overall, again, congratulations and heartiest congratulations to all. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Anil, sir?
So the judges prepared and as we decided in last couple of days, we increased the number of judges because of these internet issues. There could be one can be dropped, one need to be dropped. And in that circumstances, we had a consultation and it was in a fantastic presentation. So a couple of the things which I observed and I would like to pass to the students and mentor, as well as that is to just in a preparation for the final round, that take the grasp of your subject, the subject which is given to you, please stay to that subject and conclude it very well, that this is your conclusion. Not to make a big presentations rather than crisp presentation, where you come with the very first sentence, where first slide, where we get idea that what the subject is given. And the last slide, where you conclude that most of the thing you summarize. And then third is the content. Definitely contents are not objectionable, but too much of heavy slides or too much of long content into the slides, better to avoid. And then take the question, listen the questions, give some patience time, and then answer with the comfort, not to hurry. If you won't get one question, you won't get a less one question, it won't make much difference, but your sharp answer to that question will be the very much helpful. And similarly for the expert, when they are asking the questions, please stay only on the subject which is assigned to that particular student, not to go probably beyond the subject, preferably. So with that small note, I hand over Prasanna to make a couple of comments and then Chandra will declare the result with his comments.
So wonderful session again today. This is the fifth session that we are having. Through the length and breadth of the country, what is very gratifying is that the standard of the presentations are simply going up. It's phenomenal. And it's very nice to see the number of younger urologists who are actually keenly interested onto this subject. And the pattern in which this competition is following is also quite healthy. I think all of us will learn over a period of time. And like what Dr. Takwani said, most of the topics that we have taken, we've thought about it a lot, and with a lot of due diligence, we have given it. So it's preferable to restrict it to that particular topic. So anyway, wishing everyone the very best and hoping for a grand finale, which is due on September 15th.
Just making one announcement before Chandra speaks, that number four, Ajit performed comparatively quite well. But Ajit, you also know that you exceeded time to almost 1.5 to 2 minutes more. And that is probably go very much against in the competition. So though you perform well, you answered also well, you took the grasp of the subject well, but you have to rehearse. And that is beyond the capacity of judge to prevent the deduction of your mark on overshooting the time, because that will be probably injustice to the others, those who have remained within the time. So that is a particular note that please confine to the time which is given to you. If you complete 13 seconds before, it is perfectly all right, but don't shoot and go up beyond 1 to 2 minutes. That is generally happening every day with the one candidate. Yesterday, we had in a West John also one candidate exceeded to the almost to reach to the 10 minutes, right? So that is just a note, don't be disheartened. You will be having ample of opportunities in the coming days and months to perform. And with that, Chandra, you release the you give your comment and release the judgment. Yeah. Chandra Singh is a professor, CMC Vellore, and very deep. We are all dependable on Chandra Singh. Boss, come on. Chandra, unmute yourself. Chandra, and start from the very first. Yeah.
Yeah, first of all, I would like to thank Dr. Rajiv and Dr. Arun and all the administrators of USI for this wonderful opportunity. It's an amazing treat to be a part of this. And also a special thanks to Dr. Anil Takwani being our moderator and coordinator and the wonderful job that he has done. And I would like to thank all our senior faculty members who have given amazing input. Dr. Amila Albert, Dr. Ansari, Dr. Nyanendra, and Dr. Prasanna, and Dr. Rahul for amazingly conducting it, and Dr. Mallikarjuna, who could give his valuable inputs, especially with minimally invasive. And as Dr. Prasanna mentioned, as Dr. Anil mentioned, it's been an amazing journey and a lot of effort has gone in. So I'd like to commend the faculty as well as the students as they have put in the effort together. And as he mentioned, it was a pretty difficult job for us to decide about the who has performed the best. And we had an extensive discussion and then we have finally agreed that the best performance was of Dr. Sumit Agarwal and Dr. Swarnendu Mandal. Congratulations. And
Give the number. First and second.
Yes, first one is serial number 3, Dr. Sumit Agarwal and Dr. Swarnendu. And second one will be number 5, that is Dr. Amit Kumar Sharma and Dr. Sabyasachi Panda. So we would like to congratulate and wish all the very best in the final rounds. We look forward to seeing the amazing performance of the representatives of the East Zone competing with the other participants. I'm sure you'll do a wonderful job. And thank you very much for a great treat in pediatric urology in the evening. And I would like to specially commend Dr. Anil Takwani for his innovative ideas and enabling us to learn, especially from senior faculty who could give several valuable tips. Thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you very much, Chandra, for your taking this responsibility, because this task of judging is becoming so difficult and so tense. I can understand, and we are very much thankful to all those who have played the role of experts as well as the judges. We have to take the outcomes of the and the results pronounced by the judges with the complete positive frame of mind and with all respect. So with that, I think we have concluded all 5 preliminary rounds. And once again, thanks to the entire Council of USI and ISU for this wonderful opportunity to the pediatric urology subspecialty, and specifically Rajiv to give such a tremendous time to us in last 15 days. I think we have spent not minutes, but a couple of hours with you programming this. And without your support and the opportunity given to us, we would have not reached to this level. And definitely, I agree with you all observations that I'm getting every day in double digits, mail as well as messages for this how this competition is going on. And it has created a lot of enthusiasm into the trainees and the teachers. So with that remark, we hope that we'll be having we'll take another 4 or 5 days to come out with the exact planning of our final. And we will be allocating subject within a day or two to these 5 finalists. And with that, we will be come out with this format with the help of our experts and the you as well as Dr. Chava and all those people. So thank you very much once again. Thank you very much to all. Thank you very much to all participants.
Concluding without, comments, Dr. Rajiv.
Without your participations, your and students' participation and teachers' participation, we would have not achieved this success. And I am really thrilled when I got on first day almost more than 10 entries. And by 2 days, I got almost 20 entries. So I asked Rajiv, should we stop here? He said, no, continue for 2 more days. And subsequently, we reached to the 32. So in 4 days, 32 entries from all over the India, all from all zones, and specifically 13 entries from South. It was very overwhelming. And not only pushed you people, but pushed our morals to do more and more for the pediatric urology subspecialty, sir. So you people have boosted us. And we took this challenge also with the help of you to come out with the more and more scientific programs and we'll definitely seek your help into the future to improve ourselves, to decide on the program as well as the some scientific materials to publish, as well as to term some guidelines to prepare. Over to you, Raji.
Thank you. It was a really wonderful journey through the preliminary rounds. In fact, everyone has done very well. It was a tough competition, in fact. And there are some mistakes, actually, what I said, what agree, it's a competition, so you have to follow all the norms. If you overshoot the time, marks will be deducted. But anyway, it was a really tough competition among the participants. And as the judges has commented, it was very difficult to judge who is first and who is second. In fact, I had this problem when you assigned this duty to me last time. So anyway, it was a wonderful experience for us also, because this was put into trial. And as Anil was a little bit skeptical initially, whether we will get response or not, I said, no, we'll keep the ball rolling and see what will happen. And when he suggested, when he had 20 teams, he said, we'll stop here. I said, no, let's wait for some more time. We will have more to come. So ultimately, we had around 33 when we closed out. But one team backed out because of some problems. Ultimately, we had 32. And there was an enormous response from the South. And again, we will have the great finale of this competition. And what I have found that yesterday, this has really boosted up the other subspecialties to do something as early as possible. So they have also started the competition among themselves, because pediatric urology has started a competition, and it is a talk among most of the members across India in the urology fora. So the other subspecialties are also planning many programs, and because they are trying to compete with pediatric urology. So whenever there, only when there is a competition, everything will be lifted up, and all these sections will develop. Otherwise, if there is no competition, then development has no role at all. Everything will remain as it is, because they will fight each other to show that they are the first. So that will boost up all the subspecialties, and ultimately all subspecialties will develop. So we will march forward, and now pediatric urology has got some footing. Now it will start growing. And I think under the leadership of Dr. Anil Thokwani, he will have the pediatric urology subspecialty flag flying high. With these few words, I thank you all once again, because all of you have put in a lot of efforts. I can imagine, because I have been keeping track with this, and Dr. Anil Thokwani used to have discussion with me even the late hours also. So I know he keeps me updated about what is happening and what is the decision, and take the final concurrence from me. So you all have put in a lot of effort. It's really commendable. And I thank you all for doing this work in such a short span of time. That is commendable. Thank you very much. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you, Rajiv. Thank you very much. Thank you. Rahul, you take a permission from the Chawla sir. Mm-hmm. To declare the session over.
Over. Thank you very much. Thank you. Good night. Stay safe. Stay well. I'm waiting for grand finale now.
Right, sir. Sorry. Yes. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Will be really hope South team will win.
You have got the two teams. You got an opportunity. See, Rajiv asked me to wait, and what happened? That the South exceeded to 10. So in our meeting with the pediatric subspecialty, we asked that Rajiv, it will be unfair to have one team from the 13 teams or probably 12 teams and one team from the 6 teams. And that time North were having contributed only 4 teams actually, and East also having 4 or 5 teams. So we decided to give 2 slots to the with the permission of the Rajiv. It was his idea that we should give two slots to the South zone. So South zone is having a definitely best chance out of 5 teams. 2 contributed from the South zone. So
we'll put Chandra and Prasanna in charge for
at least like a cricket match, one day game.
B-
making them well prepared for their finale.
Who performs on that day?
Yes. And the most, sir, important is that we will be giving them subject very much in time. So yes. If they stuck to the subject purely to their given subject, justifying that particular subject, I think it will be a great presentations, because they are the best presenters. They are the one of the best presenters. You won't believe the time we finished the competition, Dr. Pramod Reddy called me within almost 1 minute that this was a wonderful experience. And definitely he would like to take it to the USA. He said that I will talk to the other friends from the various institute in the USA, but others are not joining. Then at least Cincinnati would have a program with these USI team. So that the thing is that it is really they get the sense that our students are presenting very well. Mentors are helping them to prepare very well. The level of competition is really very good. Just little bit improving into the just staying with the subject and concluding with the best possible conclusions that will make them real competitors, very tight competitors.
Actually,
we'll convey this here, sir.
Actually, Indian winners can have a competition with the American counterparts.
Yeah, we'll be definitely we'll make possible with you, help of USI ISU to have I told you, SARC, and beyond the SARC, we'll go definitely. As you got the message from the email from the Pramod, that he is very much willing to be associated or collaborate with the our efforts through the USI.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Good night. Stay safe. Stay healthy. Bye-bye.
Good night.